This episode of Lost Anarchy Presents has been brought to you by Ziggurat.com.
Moran, who plays Kane.
Right.
This is Suzanne Hargrove, who is the executive producer and the big dog here at Bandito Brothers.
Alright.
This is Marshall, who is one half of the team, Josh and Marshall, who wrote and created the show. And then
someone
else.
And he's Elliott
Lester.
Is it too cool in here, temperature-wise? Is it okay?
No. It's good.
I didn't turn it up a little.
It's a little warm. There's a lot of us.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. Yeah.
Then you
know,
make it less cold, right?
More cold.
More cold.
When you're hungover.
Put that on the table.
Hungover and heat is bad. Come on, I had leftover makeup last night. Come on.
So, who would like to kick off?
I mean, I can start off. Sean Miller at backstage. I was hoping to just, I have a kind of a specific question, so I was hoping you guys could just address casting.
Yeah, of course.
You know, how you cast these series, how do you find, you know, how'd you find Renee? How'd you guys, you know, get everyone involved?
We had Meredith Burgess, Warner Brothers, and works with John Wells.
Okay.
They cast Shameless, you know, they've got a long, long history. They, you know, in the same way that you would cast any show, you know, you throw the net out and you bring people in. What's nice about a show like this is that you get to make some discoveries.
Yeah.
You know, you're not seeing the same old faces. We had quite a specific remit in that this is a show that is hugely ethnically diverse, you know. And we wanted to make sure that that was representative of Los Angeles, because Los Angeles is an ethnically diverse city. We were able to dig into areas and bring in actors. I mean, I normally would never meet an actor like Renee Moran. I just wouldn't.
Yeah.
So, sorry.
I was going to say, did you only cast here in LA, or did
only,
you cast
nationally?
Yeah.
Only cast here in Los Angeles. And then, you know, Robert Patrick is a friend.
Hell yeah.
Hell yeah.
So I met Robert a while ago, and I called him up, and he came in and did a turn for a couple of days.
Okay.
Met some wonderful actors who I never normally would meet.
Yeah.
So it's good. It's a pleasure.
Just a quick question, and I'll get out of the way for these guys. Suzanne, for you, is there a Bandito Brothers actor? Is there someone that you guys like to work with, or a profile of a performer that you guys hired?
There is.
What? Go.
Alex Vader.
Okay.
Do you want to speak about Alex?
Go ahead.
Alex Madoff was in Act of Valor.
Yeah.
And our executive producer had said, he goes, okay, and get us Alex Madoff. And so instead of calling up his agent, we went through Facebook.
Okay.
Oh. You want to hear something?
It was Passover.
Yeah.
Right? And, you know, I'm Jewish. Alex is Jewish.
Max, the executive producer, is Jewish. So what happened is, it's like everybody well over the fast, you know, it's happy Passover, and then Alex pops up. Happy Passover. What are you doing? You want to come and work?
Yeah.
So, but Alex was in Act of Valor. He's also in The Equalizer with Denzel Washington. He's opposite Denzel. He's a fabulous actor. Yeah, I think he's a Bandito.
He's
brother.
He's a brother, yes.
Yeah.
I mean, the seals that we used in Act of Valor, have gone on to become acting and, you know, actors and that kind of thing. So we utilize them in different.
So non-traditional performers.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. In particular, well, I think it's a healthy mix. I mean, we absolutely use a lot of the traditional performers, but we're always looking, a lot of our projects are non-traditional, and so we're always looking outside of the box and trying to think of new ways to, you know, kind of recreate the wheel, as it were. Yeah, and stunt guys,
yeah.
A lot of stunt guys, so
yeah.
They, of course, are most, you know, the best in the world are union and known and actors, etc. And a lot of the stuff we do is quite dangerous, so we make sure we're well covered. Safety is always paramount.
Yeah.
And we had real prisoners as well.
Okay.
We had red lights cones.
Yeah.
Coming in, playing. Couldn't have been. We did. We had real guys who just. I mean, one of the guys, I think, he just got out of prison 2 weeks before.
Real gang members, you know.
Yeah.
They just finished their.
Are they SAG members?
They just finished their run of the park and they
did you put out a casting notes for those guys, or did you go to a specific organization?
Prisons.
literally
yeah.
Yeah.
We had an extras casting person. They came in and they met with us, and I said we had one challenging aspect. I was looking for an albino, and it was very, very difficult. We got one, but it was very, very difficult to find out transsexuals and things like that because we wanted a real prison population. But no, these guys came straight out of the yard and then onto our yard.
I actually had to post bail for Elliot.
Yeah, right. That's a whole other
immigration problem.
His whole gang. And then, Renee, what's your background? How did you get involved?
How did I get involved? My agent sent me out on an audition over to John Frank Levy's office at the Warner lot, and he had just cast me on Shameless. So then he brought me back about a week or two later and had me read for Chop Shop, and then we went through the whole process, and that's basically how I got put on. I met Elliot for the first time at the callback, and then came back for a chemistry read, and then you know now we're here. That's basically how it all happened.
We didn't go through Paramount Casting. We didn't use the traditional studio thing, although Paramount...
They did help.
Yes, they were supportive.
Yeah.
They weren't. We didn't have Joseph Middleton.
Sure.
We didn't have Joseph Middleton. But the studio were very supportive in letting us bring on who we wanted. I mean, the casting approval process was quite straightforward.
How are you approaching the challenge of differentiating this particular experience from all of the other sort of car-intensive properties that are out there now, whether it's the Need for Speed kind of thing now?
It's not about cars. Mm-hmm. The show's not about cars, it's about LA life. Mm. You know, it's what these guys do for a living. You know, you actually don't see them stealing a lot of cars, per se. This is their life. So in that regard, I mean, Fast and Furious as a franchise has become, you know, they're like an anti-terrorist organization. Yeah, so it's so different. And then Need for Speed is, you know, it's
based on a video game.
Yeah, and it's fantastical and wonderful.
No, it's horrible.
It's horrible.
It's
bad.
Marshall, really bad.
I mean, like, Marshall, who wrote the show, will tell you it's a grounded.
Yeah, we definitely had those things in mind when we were thinking about it, but we wanted to take it in a different direction, really embrace the gritty texture of LA and present characters that are realistic and present, you know, the guys that actually do these car thieves are often involved with gangs, and so we want to present that in a realistic way, such that, you know, the head honchos of the Mexican Mafia, they're all in prison, so there's a total subplot that deals with the prison population here. So those things are kind of skirted around and just kind of winked at in other stories, but we really wanted to take that on and present it realistically.
And then was there any concern about seeming as though you're glorifying this particular culture? How do you respect it and celebrate this production without, you know, saying, "And kids, this is what you should do"?
There are consequences in our story. You'll see.
You know, just a question for all of you. The difficulty of bringing in something so realistic like that, you know, as a director, as an actor, as production and such, what consequences were there? Because that's actually what I was leading to. You know, what difficulties did you find bringing in people who just came out of prison, who don't like to be told what to do, or suddenly be told, stand here, do this,
I've
do
worked
that.
With actors that are harder than people that have murdered people.
I agree!
I would say that the difference is that if you get in an actor's face, you know, the consequences aren't going to be as dire as somebody who's just got out of jail. I mean, if you step to someone who's got out of prison, they're probably going to hit you. There weren't any. There were absolutely plenty. You know, in terms of cast and dealing with cast, people knew what they were getting into. They showed up ready to work. We didn't have problems that you... Well, no, I didn't
we
really...
We didn't have problems.
We
mean,
didn't have problems.
Yeah, the actors were amazing. And you know, I think that anybody that had just gone out of prison, et cetera, they're not our leads.
Yeah.
But the actors that we had were all incredibly signed on, you know, for this project, and we're all... excited to dig in and try and create something that was pretty spectacular, and so
there's no agenting going on or anything like that. It's you know, when you sign on for, look, it's a digital show, but it's a digital show with a lot of appetite. It is for an actor, you know, actors who don't always get their shot because they're not in the mix on television with them. It's you've got a chance. You're being asked to step up, so go ahead and step up.
You do a lot of these films, from the fringe. Was there something in particular that drew you to that particular type of filmmaking?
For Chop Shop in particular. Uh-huh. Uh-huh. I mean, Elliott and I worked together in the commercial space. And and we've worked together with Josh and Marshall being here, Josh elsewhere, but on different digital projects. And I mean, really, this just fits in our wheelhouse. I mean, it's dramatic. It's pushing the envelope with respect to this new realm of digital storytelling, and it was really a no-brainer. And when we were able to package it all together and go to Paramount. And Paramount was excited about it. It just really kind of all fell into place very quickly. So this, even though it's a digital kind of project, it's kind of mainstream in a way, even though it's digital. So it's interesting. It's just a very kind of fits into the fabric of Bandito Brothers.
Yeah, that's pushing the edge.
Yeah. Yeah. Hey, you know, Renee, for all of you, you know, it's a new medium. It's a it goes right to the net. It's digital, like you're saying. What are some of the challenges compared to normal filmmaking? Is there anything that's different, or you basically just approach it the same way, acting, production, directing?
For me as an actor, like I looked at it as another job and another character to create, whatever medium, it really doesn't matter to me. That's, whatever the production side decides to do with it, that's their thing. But for me, I had a job of creating a character, and I did my best with that. And, finding my character arcs, making choices, bringing a lot of myself into the character, just going through my whole process of creating. And that's the only concern I concern. Everyone else is super talented in their departments, and you do your part, I'll bring my A game, and hopefully we all do.
There isn't a difference. It's camera, actor, hit your mark, know your lines, don't get drunk the night before. If you start sleeping with your lead actress halfway through the show,
don't stop till the end.
It's the same problem. People have to be,
you still need more money, and you still need more time, which is across the board. So it's the same way for whichever.
We're dipping, for Banditos, I think with Paramount, it's about being ahead of the curve. The bubble shifting. It's gone from network to cable. Cable's now going to digital. Mm. If you want to survive as an artist or a production company or a studio in this environment, you have to be embracing this. Mm-hmm. Bandito Brothers are forward thinkers, and this show speaks to that.
But I wanted to make sure that.
You got time.
Go!
Take your time!
We're having fun.
Practice for me.
So you talked with us about how you gathered some of your acting talent. What about the music talent? So the talent that that helps create the score, all of that.
I can tell you about that guy. Right. So I work with a composer called Mark Todd, who I've never met.
Okay.
He scored Nightingale.
Oh, okay.
Mm. Mark lives in Northern Ireland, and he writes for Ridley Scott. But he also writes for all those video games. So it was, let's try and find the language that the video gamers understand, because it comes out of Machinima again. So, when you don't have a $10 million or $20 million budget for music, you can't afford what they call needle drops.
Mm-hmm.
So I can't have like a Kid Cudi track or a Kanye West track, but I can have like, something that sounds like that.
Mm-hmm.
So it was like, how can we get we were obsessed with that ASAP Rocky track,
mm-hmm.
Bossing It.
Yeah,
Bossing It. We were obsessed with it, but we couldn't get it. We couldn't afford it. So we got something that was similar, that felt that it had the texture of the show. So you cut your cloth accordingly. You just go, okay, I can get that feeling, because the feeling is the most important thing. So work with Paramount's music department would send us their libraries of, there's a woman who lives in the valley, who writes stripper music. This is not without a word of a lie. And she writes this stripper music, and she walks out, and the story is, she wakes up in the morning, she has a cup of coffee, the kid goes to school, and she sits at home and she writes this crazy music, And for the stripper staff, it was all that. It was like, okay, so some woman living in Tarzana is getting a stank on at like 10 a.m. So you go to areas you can't normally go to.
Sure.
And but you see, the thing is, you wouldn't know that. So, and I think the story's sometimes more interesting than the reality.
Absolutely. And then, so as an actor, how much of this music did you hear as you were acting out the scenes and how much of it came in during post?
You know what I did actually? Elliott sent me a list of tracks that I guess Paramount must have sent over.
Yeah, these weren't library music, this was actual music. Strip from the valley.
No, I don't know if those tracks were on.
No,
he sent me a list and I just kind of wanted to feel out the temperature of the music and just kind of see what tracks were on there. And for me, I believe it helped, you know, just kind of submerging myself in that list of music. Thinking it's going to go towards the show, and it just helped, you know, with some of my choices. It's really what it did.
Well, we treated it as well, and normally you put your music in post. What's very nice about the way we all work together is that the edit bay was open, so we would all have an input. Everyone had a thought. You'd listen to it, you know, because I don't always have the answers. It's impossible. That's why you have great collaborators like Suzanne and Josh and Marshall. Mm-hmm. You know, we just go, okay, I don't think that works. And, you know, most of the time they're right, because you're too close to it, you know.
Joshua, when you're writing, when you're doing your action scenes and things like that, what do you pull from, or what do you, you know,
well,
visualize?
Well, when we first started this project, we started a dialogue with Elliott and kept it ongoing, so mm-hmm. we would talk about other cinematic references, like, you know, Drive or Live and Die in L.A. or other things like that that weren't necessarily things we wanted to borrow from directly, but just more inspiration either about tone or environment or certain character arcs or ways to handle things or not handle things. So it was something from the beginning that we just had open dialogue, just like he was talking about in post, from the very get-go.
Thanks.
What was your research process like?
Well, Josh and I have been writing partners for many years now, like 12 years, and so a lot of the research we had actually already done for other projects, so we knew a lot about how gangs worked from just talking to various people who'd been in gangs and reading books, and so we definitely had kind of an idea of this world in part, and so then to see that through the lens of a gang of car thieves, it just sort of brought it all into focus. So we came to it with a little bit of a head start, you know, not from scratch, because once we sold this project, we were writing it almost in pre-production immediately. So it was very helpful to sort of have the grounding knowledge in the way that gangs operated on a certain level without having actually gone somewhere. So that was really helpful.
What made you want to do a TV show as opposed to a feature?
Part of it is this sort of new medium that's quickly becoming the standard, is just that things happen, you have a much better chance of things happening, period. So we've worked in the feature space for years now, and they just move glacially, to be honest. Whereas we sold this project last spring, we're in production that fall, and it's up coming out this Friday. Like, so that cycle is very attractive. To not have things languish in development hell, you know, as the phrase goes. So that's probably the biggest upside, is the chance to not just write something, but actually have it made, and made on the quality of this level.
Get it seen. I mean, the studios are making 11 movies a year. You know, they've cut their quota down to like a tenth, mm-hmm. you know, so you know that it's shifting over there.
What I asked was the future for this, in your eyes, expand it into a feature, do some more series like this, or is it a, you know, one shot deal?
That would be in the hands of the gods.
Depends how popular it is.
The goal, to be honest, is to do good work. And if something only has one season, it's still good. It's good. Mm-hmm. If something has 10 seasons, it's great. I think you're just a little bit more pragmatic about it. Did we have fun doing this? Yeah, we have fun doing it. Do we like it? Are we proud of it? Absolutely. You know. Is it going to be Chop Shop 58? I'll tell you, there'll be Fast and Furious 58.
It's looking in the refrigerator at some point.
How many episodes are you guys making?
We made six.
Ah.
You know.
Six 22-minute episodes.
Mm. Oh, cool.
Which is the kind of cable format as well.
Yeah.
I mean, there's always the hope that it will continue on in some form. Right. Oh, let's be serious. I mean, it'll be like, one and up to, you know, season two, et cetera, or if Paramount decided that they'd like it for a different medium, if they wanted it to, you know, as a springboard for features, sure. We'd all love that, but as Elliott said, you know, it's in Paramount's hands, really.
It's an interesting time because it's also a great way to incubate television. You know, it is a, you know, if you think about the way a typical studio behaves in terms of television, they'll spend 37, 40 million a year in developing shows and producing pilots, and those pilots never go anywhere. Yeah. Whereas what you've got with this is that people are going to see it, you can generate advertising, you can generate revenue off it. You know, it doesn't just disappear.
You know, for all of you, you know, like you were mentioning, digital is a new medium. At what point in your career did you think this was going to be part of your career? So I know half different people say, well, early on, or just, you know, last year. Was there a point?
Well, it's a tough time. I mean, personally, I come from advertising. And I've been at Bandito for 2.5 years. And part of the reason I came here is because Bandito Brothers, as somebody mentioned, is at the forefront of this kind of digital world. And advertising in general has also shifted quite a bit from the traditional advertising, which is still important, to more of a branded content, digital kind of, you know, content from a 30-second digital commercial all the way to, we just did a 44-minute TV show that was paid for by Pennzoil. So basically, for me, the shift, I think I forgot the question. I was on my way. But so it's been an evolution. And I would say that in this longer form space, it's been probably the last year and a half. And I think that inevitably, the digital space that we're in with Chop Shop and the digital space that we're in advertising is all marrying together.
So right now,
I'd say probably a year.
So 18 months from now.
What was the budget for the episodes?
It was enough to get it done, and it's the scale of a TV show, so I'd say probably more along the lines of a feature.
Well, is there
getting sponsorship
in terms of getting sponsorship and pairing with advertising? Does that
happen
for you guys, or does that happen further down the chain?
That's Paramount.
PhD camera to pick up with the advertising.
Any alignments, any of that kind of things.
What was your biggest budget hurdle?
Action.
Like on a movie.
Yeah, stunts, action, crashing cars, driving fast, all involved, police,
qualified, stunt, rigging, talent, and removal, and so on and so forth. So the biggest hurdle on this job would have been, what was the location We were actually just talking about this. We were quite fortunate to find Nellis, a correctional facility, which is a place where they shoot a lot of TV shows and films, etc. And we were able to bar Sophia's house, a bunch of our locations on that particular property, so that we were there for. Sounds big. 70 days. This is why I have to ask. This is why this is what Elliot is. I have found a place that I think can house, you know, 30% 40% of the shoot. That's what you have. You know what? That's what you have. They come up with crowd solutions for you that allow the show to be good. We had fun. So, you know, definitely when we went looking for, what's her name, Tanis.
Tanis
Sophia's
house.
We went to Sophia's house. We went to a couple locations, a lot of locations. We rode up. I like it. I'll tell you about it. Thank you.
Thank you, guys. Yeah, I love it. Thank you.
All right.
Yeah, I love it.
All right.
The brand new issue of Lost Anarchy magazine is now currently available throughout the city. And we are now a paid publication. And I, Captain Anarchy, am spotlighted in the new issue with a 4-page column where you can read about all of the rest of my adventures from 2013 all the way up through the first quarter of 2014. The new issue also features an in-depth interview with HTTH, Heavenly Trip to Hell, bringing the underground to the streets.
Oh, yeah!
As well as articles from our other featured writers, including Gypsy Blacks, and the Buzz legal column, Ultimate Band Girl, Rob Sheriff, and many, many more.
Oh, yeah.
For the rest of you collectors and readers that would like to order a physical copy of the magazine, you can do so for only $2.50 at comicfleamarket.com, where you can order it online. Or if you can catch up with Mojo El Diablo and his crew at the San Diego Comic-Con this year, they will also have issues available with them. This is Captain Anarchy signing off, and I hope to catch you all in the clubs. See ya! See ya!
Thank you for watching. Don't forget to like and subscribe, or I will scratch your eyeballs out.
This episode has been brought to you by Ziggurat.com. There's nothing fake about it. We're the source for electronic cigarettes. Welcome to the 21st century. Quit smoking and start vaping. No tar, no secondhand smoke, no pollution, no offensive odors. Smoke without the guilt. We carry everything from egos to traditional electric cigarettes and a full line of accessories. So please come on down to Ziggurat.com. All of our flavors are produced right here in the United States. And we can even say our flavors are kosher. So for the best flavors, the best vaping experience you can get, go to Ziggurat.com. And remember, all the flavor you will get vaping on your cigarette. At Ziggurat.com. That's Z-I-G-R-E-T.com.